recognize that. Because Walt and Tyler and Ryan are usually part of the usher team at this mess. Actually, don't worry, they're coming back over there after the holiday. And I always thought it was just interesting and a great thing that the three of you guys do this. And Cathy, you've been supporting them and everything like this. But and in this past week, and then plus the time that I talked to Walt initially about doing this, there was a scripture verse that is just solid. It was the first thing out of both of your mouths as far as how you live as a family. And this was the wedding reading, the gospel for your mass. And it was that the church is built on solid foundation, and that your family is built on this foundation of Jesus Christ. And this verse is so important to you that why don't you share it with us? Cathy, why don't you share with us how, what you've done with this verse then?
Smart man who built his house on stone, and the floods came and the waters came and it washed away the sand and the house stood still. And then there was the foolish man who built his house in the sand, and the floods came and the waters came and washed the sand away and the house crumbled. And we decided that we wanted to live our life and start a family that way, on a solid foundation, and teaching that way through church. And then as the priest of each baptized here at St. Alphonsus, we had Father O'Connor read that same gospel, because that was adding each member to our family and confirming that we wanted to build that on a solid foundation.
And so that's always been very, very important. So four times that solid foundation of God's faith is important to you as a family. How do you do that reading? The cool reading?
Yeah.
Make you feel good? You think your parents are pretty cool in doing that?
Yeah.
Ryan? Yeah. Okay. Now, as a family too, you guys have gotten involved in the passion play. Walt, you went first.
I was approached by Patty's messages in the choir to, since the boys had ushered and I was an usher, that would be nice for me to participate in the passion play. So I had said that I would think about it, and then when I left church that Sunday, when I was in the truck, my wife asked, what did Patty want? I said she wanted me to be a part of the passion play. My wife started laughing because she knows that I'm not very good with plays or theatrical by no means. I'm actually a union carpenter, so the audience could imagine sort of how I act. And so it was very difficult the first time to do it. First couple of nights of practice here at church, there were so many young kids, teenagers, that I really felt I was out of place. But I thought for Lent, this would be a great chance, and so therefore I continued through it. It was very difficult. I had a lot of support from my wife. She still couldn't believe I was going through it. The day came to do the passion play for the first night on Friday night. I had three other brothers. They all showed up with smelling sauce in case I passed out. They sat in the front row. But after I got through and I was up on stage, I was fine because the Lord was in me and helping me get through everything. And after I was all done, the two boys came into the locker room over at the gym. And they said, Dad, I'll be in the play next year, but me not going to be Jesus because of how everything took place. So that following Sunday, we're in the back of church on Sunday. The boys are reading for the missalette. They're back here reenacting the whole passion play. And so I just looked up into the heavens and I said, what a great thing that I did. And I will not ever quit doing it because it sends such a great message to not only the adults in the parish, but to all the young children. And I think today we're so used to reading from the Bible, the scripture, but there's not a lot of visual. And doing the play and seeing visual things and bringing it back to how we read and study, I just think that's awesome. And that's why I like to participate, and the boys do too.
So you've been doing this for 4 years now.
I have.
Okay, and boys, you've been doing it for 3 years. Yeah. Now, I understand that you guys did a little show at home. Was it this year or last year?
This year.
This year? Okay. Those are the, yeah, I need to jump up there. Now, what was the guy's name that you did this for?
Marty.
Marty. And did Marty know anything about Jesus?
No.
No. So what did you guys tell him about?
Well, we did our play, we showed him, and we talked to him for a little bit. And then he's like, oh, and then he said some stuff.
Okay. That's pretty cool. So you were telling him about Jesus. And how old were you now?
Eight? Nine.
Oh yeah, let's get that right. So at 9, you're telling him about Jesus. Did you think you should be older to tell him about Jesus?
No.
I don't think so either. I think 9's a great age to tell him about Jesus. I think 8, 7, 6, and 5, and 4, and 3, and 2, and 1 are good ages to tell him about Jesus. I think that's pretty cool that you guys did that. Now, as a family, you guys do something really, really special with Thanksgiving time, too. What do you do, Cathy?
Every year at Thanksgiving, we usually find somebody that doesn't have a family to go to. Sometimes it's neighbors, so their parents have passed away, or they don't have brothers and sisters. And Walt usually goes, because they're usually older, Walt usually goes and picks them up and brings them to the house for dinner. And they spend the day there, and then we send them home with a few days' worth of supplies. And we also have a friend, Sister Michelle, who has since retired. And a lot of the sisters in the home that she's at have other places they want to go, so sometimes we have her over for them too. And the boys get all excited because they get to go pick her up, and I think that's really neat to go visit her over there, because they have an ice cream machine, so.
Yeah, good too. So, I mean, it sounds like everything is like really great and cheerful and always going your way, but that hasn't been the case. Because, after which child was it, Cathy, that you lost the job?
After I had Tyler, I worked for a company almost right out of high school, well, preschool. I was a supervisor, and it was a very small, close-knit family kind of company. And when I found out I was having Tyler, I went to my boss, and I did a lot of work from home. And I asked if it was be okay if I work part-time, in the office. And, oh, it was fine with him, not a problem. And, you know, every 9 months I'd go for my doctor appointment, and I'd go back in and visit him and say, you know, are you sure? Because, you know, we're making these plans. And, oh, no, sure, no problem. And I had Tyler on a Sunday, and Monday rolled around, and I worked all the way up to that Friday. So Monday morning I called and said I wouldn't be in that day, explained why. And it was like I fell off the face of the earth. There was, you know, no email saying congratulations. There was no cards from anyone I'd worked with for 17 years. And there was also now no job. They had changed their mind. So because it was a very small company, there was about 15 or 16 employees, I really didn't have any choice but to take it with a grain of salt. And since I was already home with him, I decided, well, might as well have another one. And, so I've been a stay-at-home mom ever since, and we just make a budget and make it work with what we have with Walt's salary. And eventually, I guess when Luke goes back to into kindergarten, then we'll see what happens with the work till then.
But because of the foundation,
we make things work.
With God's grace, you've done that, and faith has been solid. And even in First Communion gifts. What's the tradition, guys? What's the tradition for First Communion gifts? What did you get Tyler and Ryan got also?
A Bible.
Very good. And Ryan, you were very excited when you got your Bible this year. And you were looking to find the different readings from Sunday in there, weren't you? So you make your dad find the book, and then you go and read them. Did you bring it with you today? Not, well, because of the procession today, it's kind of weird. But I know you said you wanted to bring it with you and keep it back you with you so that you could follow along in Mass. All of these different things are great because of the solid foundation that you have come together with. Not because everything in life went right and perfectly, but because with God, you guys have made a beautiful life together. But with God in it, everything looks good. With God, all things are possible. And with God, you just keep giving. Some people have been thrown for a tailspin and not recovered. But you guys just keep loving and giving and sharing here in ministry and supporting each other. And That is, to me, the end of today's gospel. I pray that you might have life and have it in abundance. And I truly believe that you guys are sharing the abundance of life of Jesus Christ. And now, Ryan, after last week, you get to come back to the altar for communion. So, as a family, we get to do this. So Luke, one of these days, he'll be out there. He's busy giving fist bumps. But I think it's a great witness, and since I've seen you guys and your boys, especially your boys, handing out papers and bulletins, I just thought that was awesome that you guys do this for your family and support each other and make sure that everything happens. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
God bless you.